Our presenter is Mike Stump, and he will be talking to us about how to stop the bleed. This is something we can all learn how to do, even if we do not have a medical background, and the satisfaction of knowing that we have helped save a life.
Just as an introduction, I'm an EMT, emergency management coordinator. I also do search and rescue. I volunteer with the Medical Reserve Corps and serve OR, also part of the Beaverton and Tigard CERT groups, and participate, train, and work with them, and they with me. As we were speaking a moment earlier, it's like you can never get enough information, can never get enough experience. There's always more to learn and constantly moving forward. What we're going to be talking about today is how to stop life threat bleeding. Any bleed could be devastating. I don't want to lose any blood myself at all, not even a drop. So any blood that someone else is losing, I want to be conscious about their loss and try to deal with them. There are a number of things that we look for with life threat bleeds, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then there's a number of ways that we can deal with life threat bleeds. And this is a national program, Stop the Bleed. It was a project that was introduced by the Hartford Census, the American College of Surgeons, Trauma Center. So we have a lot of backing with this program. I would akin it to working with CPR AED. So with CPR AED, the effort is that we give the person who has had a heart attack to give them a chance to live until emergency medical gets there to take over. Stop the bleed is very similar. We engage with the patient, make it so that we can give them a chance to live, not bleed out, until medical professionals get there and can take care of the problem. All we're doing is just stemming the bleeding, making it so that they can have a chance to live. So we're going to focus on immediate response, the dealing with the life threats, and then ways to stopping. There are some images in this program that if you're kind of squeamish, you need to be forewarned. There's some large open wounds, and okay, you've been forewarned. Why we need this training. So life threat bleeds can happen just about at any time. You take a fall and you catch on something sharp or pointed. You could cut into a large artery or a large vein. Either one of those would be potential life threats. Work-related injuries, a shooting, mass or otherwise. Motor vehicle crashes, people can have compound or open fractures. That's the same term, it's just one is an old term, one's a new term. You can have an explosion of some kind, whether it's in the kitchen, in the garage, or somebody plants a bomb someplace. Any of those are capable of rupturing veins and vessels that you can incur a life threat bleed. So anywhere, at any time. Again, similar to a heart attack, it can happen anywhere. So if we're ready as the public to deal with the situation, we can give the person who has had the problem a chance to live. Otherwise, they have zero chance. Anytime you want to engage with your patient, you always want to make sure that you're safe. Above everything else, you need to be safe. You're the most important person, because if you're not safe and able to give aid to this person, possibly no one will. So you are, in fact, the most important person. You have to be safe. You have to make sure the scene is safe for you. You have to make sure the environment is safe for you. Also, wearing gloves, putting on nitrile gloves, is your best avenue to protect yourself from bloodborne pathogens, getting sticks, any kind of infection on you. Get contaminated is the term we use. It is a contamination. So you have to protect yourself at any cost, including not engaging with the patient. If you're not safe, don't engage. It seems heartless, but you have to be safe, particularly in a disaster. So we were talking about disasters today. In a disaster, you might have multiple people that need your help. And if you get hurt or injured with this one, all of the others are going to suffer because you're not there. So seriously, 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 you need to take care of yourself. You're number one. You have to be safe. So the first thing that we do after we put on our gloves, we make sure our scene is safe, is we call 911. If you're involved, it's bad enough. Get some help there. However that it happens, you tell somebody to get you help, you either get the help yourself, call 911, send somebody down the street, whatever it is. You need your help coming right now. If it turns out that it's not a problem, that's okay. If they really didn't need the ambulance help or the EMS help, that's okay. I've been on a number of calls where I was turned around, search and rescue and on an ambulance, and it was perfectly fine. There was no hard feelings. In fact, it was kind of like, oh, cool. They're safe. That's a good thing. So get help on the way first. Then we have to find the bleeders. And then we're going to put compression on that bleed. And there's a number of ways we can put compression on a bleeding wound. And we'll talk about that. Okay? So, obviously, 911, yay. This is really a simple thing, but it has to be said every time. A lot of people forget. They just go, oh, help! And they jump right in. They forget that they need backup. Professionals call for backup. Fire, medical, police, we always call for backup. It's better to have it on its way than not have it at all. So finding the bleeding. Typically a life-threat bleed will have some serious, obvious signs. You might see spurting. If it's an arterial bleed coming straight off of the heart, it's under a lot of pressure and it will spray blood. It's very graphic. Another way that you can tell there's a life threat bleed is that the clothing is becoming soaked. If there's enough blood to soak the clothes, it's enough blood to be life threatening. Or pooling, like soaking, if it's starting to pool, that's way too much blood to be lost. There's a major problem, and we need to try to figure out how to deal with that, okay? Oh yeah, the other thing is, when a person is lost a limb, we're gonna consider that a major bleed. Although amputations don't necessarily bleed badly, there's reasons for that, and I could go into that afterwards if you wish. The other thing is, if a victim is bleeding some, you see some blood, but it doesn't seem bad, but they're becoming confused. They can't answer simple questions for you. That's a serious problem. It is a possibility they're going into shock, and we have to go find out what is wrong with that. There's a bleed someplace that's causing this major problem. Let's find it. And if that means ripping clothes, that means ripping clothes, cutting them away. You can do that with respect for the person. You know, if there's a leg wound and you're looking for it, you don't have to cut the pants off. You can cut up the pant and expose all the leg without exposing the genitals at all. It's a very respectful thing to do, and you don't have to worry about that. But getting to that wound is the most important thing you have to worry about. Stopping the bleed, right? Okay. So, it's a little bit hard to see, but this right here, that arc, is an arc of blood being spurted from that artery. This is, by the way, sorry if I didn't give you forewarning, but this is a calf muscle. That's a knee.
Ow.
That's a bone. So, and there's all this blood. Either one of these is life-threatening. Either one of these are preventable, okay? The most preventable death in a traumatic situation is bleeding out. We saw that in Nevada with that mass shooting. There were a number of people that were saved because some others were giving care and stopping the bleed. Some did not get that care. People didn't know how. They weren't able to engage, and people died, but they could have lived. So bleeding wounds on the extremities are very easy to take care of. We can use direct pressure, we can use tourniquets, we can use packing, and that's very easy to take care of, not a problem. It gets a little more tricky with, and amputations as well, because we can put the tourniquet above the amputation. That's not a problem. Well, sorry. It is a problem. It is workable. We can deal with that. Joints are very much more difficult to deal with. So at the junction of the extremities, the arms, the hips, right, the neck, these are very difficult to deal with. We can use direct pressure. We can use packing the wound to deal with this. But we can't use a tourniquet. That is not an option for us because we can't put the tourniquet above the wound. Abdominal or torso wounds, there really isn't anything we can do except maybe put a patch over the wound itself to stop the blood from coming out, but we can't stop where it's bleeding. Particularly if stab wounds and gunshot wounds, the damage is very deep and they have to get to a hospital very fast. If this is an occasion that you're involved with, make sure that 911 knows that that's the case, okay? While en route, the EMS people may be preparing for that eventuality. So we've called 911, we found our bleed, now we have to figure out what to do with it. So what I'm going to be talking about next are the techniques that we use for stopping the bleed. Direct pressure is one of the best ways we can do that. When you're doing direct pressure on a life threat bleed, in other words, a lot of blood, you want to use your whole body weight. You want to put both hands on the wound. You want to push down hard. And it is painful. If it's a small bleed, like a little cut on the arm, you can put your fingers, you remember you got your gloves on, you can put your fingers right on the wound and press hard. And that would probably do it, 10, 15 minutes, and it may have stopped bleeding by then. And you could put another dressing on there, some more gauze and something, and make sure it's all bandaged up nice. But with a major bleed, you're gonna have to be putting your body pressure on that limb space and push hard. And yeah, it's gonna hurt quite a bit. Yes, ma'am.
The victim, you're saying, so there's nothing between the pressure and the wound. There's no bandage or absorbing gauze or anything.
Sure.
You're pressing on just directly on the open wound.
So you get some kind of something to put on that to help soak up the blood, right? It may even start a clot. But I was just speaking about the direct pressure. Putting the dressing in place is just fine. Whether the dressing is a stack of gauze, a bandage, or somebody's t-shirt, it's better not to use your t-shirt, you know, because you may need that to keep yourself healthy. You'll remember, you're the most important. You have to stay healthy, warm, doing the work, right? So see if somebody else can get you their shirt or jacket or whatever. But you could use the material to put on the wound to help. The issue is we have to deal with the bleeding right now, and you have to be rather decisive about it. So the fact that it hurts means that you're doing it right. If they say it hurts, you're pushing hard enough, okay? Once you start applying pressure, you don't stop. So we've been talking about stopping the bleed, and the basic things is to get 911, find the bleed wherever it is, and then apply direct pressure. So in this picture, basically a leg wound, and instead of my suggestion, he's taking his jacket off and putting it on the wound. And that's okay. That's his choice, right? And he's got both hands pushing down hard.
Just
okay?
Above the wound.
Now, actually, he's on the wound.
On the wound.
So the wound is
on the upper side.
So the wound is right there,
yeah.
And he's pushing right down. You don't want to push anywhere above or below the wound. If you're using direct pressure, you want to push directly on the wound. If it's a very wide wound, mm-hmm. as in that earlier picture on the guy's calf, mm-hmm. that's going to be tough. But you're going to have to, if that's all you've got, that's what you've got.
It says to continuously apply pressure, but let's say you're in a situation where you have to do other things.
stay for 10 minutes?
Well,
what do you do?
In an urban setting, you won't have anything else to do. That should be your job. If something else needs to be done, there should be somebody around. And if it's you telling them to do that, then you can coach people, go do this thing, go do that thing. Or come here, put your hands right here, put all your weight on it, push hard. Now you're free.
It doesn't bleed stop within a certain length of time?
No. Not a major bleed. The major bleed is under so much pressure from the heart or under so much, you know, force that it will not clot properly. So after 10, 15 minutes, that's considered a minor injury, a bleed. It's bleeding enough, and yeah, you could lose blood off of it. But it will clot, and it will take care of itself in time. But a life threat bleed has way too much pressure against it to actually clot. While you're holding pressure, it may start to clot. But the moment you let off, there's so much pressure, it's just going to wash it away. I'm talking about at least half an hour. Because when they get there, we don't know. Sometimes they get there in 5 minutes, sometimes they don't.
In this illustration, it's a limb.
Mm-hmm.
Is a tourniquet being used in addition
to? No, not in this case.
Okay.
My guess, if I had to say what that was, I would guess that he does not have a tourniquet on hand. Without a tourniquet on hand, direct pressure is your best bet.
He could use the sleeves on that white shirt.
To
tourniquet.
Actually, that's not ineffective. It's very ineffective. If that's the only thing you have, it's just your last ditch effort, mm-hmm. A makeshift tourniquet is what you would use. But you know up front that it's not going to do the job. It's very ineffective. True. That's true. One of the reasons why, as my understanding, is that because they were so ineffective, it was just like not useful. And they were worried about losing the limb. And medical expertise has enhanced to the point where they can actually take care of the problems that are engaged with the tourniquet. The body's building up toxins below the tourniquet is one of the problems. And so medical science has taken care of that. They can work with that now for quite a long, you know, hours now. So we have hours to deal with this, with a tourniquet. No longer is it just 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15, 20 minutes. Okay? So this is another thing we can use. Instead of direct pressure, we can use a tourniquet. This is the brachial artery under there. It's a big artery right on the inside of your arm, and you'll bleed out in very short order with that. So a tourniquet can stop the flow. A tourniquet does not always stop the flow, no matter how tight you put it on. And there's physiological reasons for that, but just know up front. It's a great tool, but if you expect it to completely shut off the blood every single time, you may be disappointed because it won't. Most often, yes, but not every single time. If applied correctly, it says it will flow it, it'll stop it. It's not been true in the field. If you have a wound that's not, you can always put a second one on place. And that's a fine technique. It may or may not stop the bleed altogether. But at that point, the pressure is so low, you can bandage it up. You can put direct pressure in place. And that's a third thing that you can do. It does limit blood loss. And of course, people go into shock and then they die. If you have a tourniquet, you put it on. If you see a life threat, in other words, you see blood spurting, you see blood pooling, you see blood soaking, you find the bleed, you put a tourniquet on the wound. If you have it, you put it on. Do not try direct pressure first. Don't waste your time. Mm-hmm. If you have a tourniquet, put it on. You have 911 coming, right? You have your gloves on. You're going to put this tourniquet in place, and you're going to use it to save this person's life. Trying direct pressure may just cause them to lose that much blood that they're now in complete life threat. Okay? You place it 2 to 3 inches above the wound. However, if the wound is is near a knee, just below the knee, you put it above the knee, an inch or two. Same with the elbow. Do not put the tourniquet on joints. Okay? It causes damage. It's a really, really bad thing. Okay? Pockets. Most people don't wear cargo pants, you know, but if somebody put a tourniquet right here on my leg, the things in my pocket would actually inhibit the tourniquet from doing its job and also dig this stuff into my skin, which would really, you know, it's just going from bad to worse, right? So check the space as you put the tourniquet in place. And then you tighten it up to stop the bleed. So there are a number of different tourniquets available. This particular tourniquet is a Gen 7, Generation 7 tourniquet. It is a combat applied tourniquet, and it is very useful for putting on yourself or somebody else. These devices have some very specific properties about them that make them really useful. One of them is that it has what's called a windlass that you use to tighten it up, and as you twist it, it tightens this band and draws the whole thing tight pretty evenly. So you get compression from all sides in closing it. As you can see, it's kind of in a spot. If I put my fingers through here, grab this red tab. That's how fast, that's all you need. So at this point, I can take this, turn the windlass. I'm going to turn it just once. I mean, and I also know right up front, this is going to be painful. It hurts. Okay, so even this tiny bit, okay, that's, what is that, half a turn? Uh-huh. So half a turn, and I can feel the pressure
already.
The thing you do is you turn it until the bleeding stops, or until you can't turn it anymore. And you turn it a lot. And you can imagine if this is uncomfortable, how much really setting the tourniquet into place, turning it hard to stop the bleed, it's going to be very, very painful. Again, just like direct pressure, pain doesn't mean that you did anything wrong. It means it's going right, okay? Once you tighten this up, and you can have the windlass on the outside for your benefit. For me, I put it on the inside because that's where I can reach it. Once the windlass is in place, I bring the strap all the way around, hook it inside the little clips, and then bring it around and wrap it the rest of the way. Yes, very much so. Then you put the strap over that, and you write the time. Once you do that, this stays in place. It does not move. Don't loosen it. Don't take it off. Don't change it. If you add a second one, fine. That's fine. But this stays. It goes to the hospital with the patient. They take it off.
How would you determine that a second one was required?
You're having still a lot of flow in the wound. And it's a judgment call, and if you just want to do it because, it's fine. That's fine. These tourniquets are Amazon's selling them, and this is not an endorsement for Amazon, it's just where I've seen the price for about $26, which is a big, because this one cost me $45. It's a big change in the cost of these things. So the price has come down a lot. There you go.
Is there damage to the lower part of the extremity that you applied the tourniquet?
Over a period of time, there will be. Understand that what I've done is I've stopped the circulation, so I've turned the blood off to all of the. Blood is the carrier of groceries. One of my friends brought this up, Harold. It's It brings in the groceries to the cells of the body and takes out the trash. So when I shut off that blood, no, there's two things happening. One, the groceries aren't coming in to each cell, and the trash isn't coming out. So I get a buildup of trash, and it goes anaerobic. It becomes in a non-oxygen state. Right now it's aerobic, an oxygen state. And then, so you can see this stuff, it just goes from bad to worse when you put the tourniquet on. But they can fix that. The hospitals can work with that. It's a whole lot better than the person bleeding out. So even losing the limb is a lot better than losing the life. Thank you, ma'am.
It goes back here.
Thank you. There are a number of different tourniquets out there. Some are better than others. And if you start thinking about buying a tourniquet, you want to get serious about carrying tourniquets, this may be one to carry for your personal use. Buy yourself a cat tourniquet. And then start looking at other tourniquets to use on other people. There are different types. The thing you want to be sure of is that it's wide enough so it doesn't destroy tissue. I mean, it breaks it down because of the pressure. And that it's strong enough. Some of the very cheap, like $2, $3, $4 tourniquets out there, they will snap. They will break very easily because of how much pressure is necessary to actually do the job. So be careful and mindful when you're thinking about buying a tourniquet.
What about the rat tourniquet?
I am not fond of that one myself. I use two different tourniquets. One is the cat tourniquet and the other is a SWAT tourniquet. The SWAT tourniquet looks a lot like a therapeutic band, you know, you use for physical therapy, except it's thicker and stronger, and it's about 4 or 5 inches wide. And it's a very, very useful thing to put on somebody else. I can't put it on myself because of how much pressure it takes. I need two hands to make it work.
Is a man's belt a sufficient tourniquet in an emergency?
There is no evidence in my mind that supports the use of a makeshift tourniquet. Okay. Belt, shoestrings, scarf, tie, cravat, you know, triangular bandage, any of those things. If that's all you have, if you have nothing else to stop the bleed with, okay. But if you have a tourniquet at all, direct pressure at all, or something to pack in the wound, then use those first. Oh, there we go. We're going to talk a little bit about that. So those are the pieces, the strap, the windlass itself, and then the band. Kind of review, putting it in place, pulling it, securing it, make sure that it's caught on the Velcro, twist it until the bleeding stops, or you can't twist it anymore. You may get that far. Hook it into the little clip, put the band over top of it like I showed you, and then put the strap on top of that and write your time. There's the thing about the two. So you can put a second tourniquet right above it. So instead of 2 inches of tourniquet, now you have 4 inches of tourniquet.
Is it likely the patient would be unconscious?
The answer is no, it's not unlikely, but they may be because of the pain, or they may be because of blood loss. I wouldn't be able to tell, but that's a possibility. Recently, we don't have any amputations based on tourniquet use. We're not losing limbs here. And then, like I said before, it's better to risk that than the patient's life.
On the previous slide, it said they're very difficult. The first bullet point, difficult to make and apply without extensive practice.
Improvised. The thing is that even well-practiced, making your own tourniquet, it's hard to get them wide enough, and it's hard to get them tight enough.
So forego the whole idea.
If you can plan to not use them, in other words, have tourniquets on hand, I carry two of them with me all the time, one for me and one for my patient, I might get hurt.
You might.
And so plan that you will not need to improvise. That way, if you have to improvise, it has gone so bad and it is so far south that whatever you do is a good thing. But improvised tourniquets are not very effective at all. And I guess I'll just say, I don't have a slide for this, but I will say, you take a cravat, you make it about 3 inches wide. A cravat is a triangle bandage or something like that. Make it, if you can, 3 inches wide. Wrap it around the limb. Tie an overhand knot. Put something inside that overhand knot. Tie another overhand knot. And tie another overhand knot on top of that, and then lock it in. Then start twisting. Here's the problem with improvised. When you twist them and start pulling them tight, they condense down into a smaller band.
Narrow.
They narrow down.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just a property that you've taken this and you've tied a knot in it, which draws it together. Mm-hmm. And you start tightening that, it's just going to narrow it all the way down.
And the skin is swelling so that it...
At that point, the skin's not swelling, but you're compressing the tissue underneath the cravat.
Okay.
Yeah, they hurt a lot. Pain doesn't mean it's wrong. Pain doesn't mean to take it off. In fact, I had one guy tell me that sometimes he takes an ACE bandage and wraps it around the tourniquet so the patient can't rip at the tourniquet because it hurts so much. Common mistakes is not using it quick enough. If you have a tourniquet and you recognize a life threat bleed, use the tourniquet. Do not hesitate. How much blood do you want to lose?
None.
Yeah, neither do they. You might not make it tight enough because the patient is starting to scream. And you'll want to stop turning the tourniquet. If the blood hasn't stopped, their screaming will stop. If you don't put that tourniquet in place well, their screaming will stop. But it's not going to be a good reason. Sometimes you need a second tourniquet, okay? So, it is a hesitation you may feel bad for the patient, and you might want to loosen it up a little bit for them. Can't do that. Yeah?
So if the situation looks like you need a second tourniquet, and you recognize that quickly it has stopped that a little additional pressure, you still can't alter the first one. You have to leave.
So if I put the tourniquet in place and I think I need to get it a little bit tighter, I can make that one tighter.
But if you've applied the first one,
uh-huh,
and you see that you require a second one, you leave the first one alone.
Yes, absolutely. So any other questions?
How long do you leave it on? If it's an earthquake and there is no trauma center available and no paramedics with you, just neighbors, how long can you leave the tourniquet on? Can you leave it on?
You leave it on.
Oh, just continue to leave it on.
So the alternative is this. The alternative is this. And I don't know how to answer those questions because that's incredibly hard. And
so many variables, what kind of wound it is, but...
Right. But the problem is the scenario plays out like this. If I have somebody who had a life threat bleed, and I put the tourniquet in place on one of their limbs, mm-hmm, a day goes by, mm-hmm, and I say, it's good enough because it's bleeding stopped, it's all coagulated over, you know, I've got a scab going on there, I've got bandages and everything, I'm going to release this.
How do you clean a wound that has a tourniquet right above it? Like, if that's when you see that it's starting to heal over a little bit, like you said, there's a little bit of a scab, you're cleaned it.
My guess is, so I'm guessing here, yeah, I've never done this because this is not protocol.
No.
If you chose to take that tourniquet off, mm-hmm, I would guess that scab would get blown off by the pressure. Yeah.
Okay.
Not secure at all.
It's not, yeah.
And it's a hard, nasty piece of business. Even in a disaster, you're going to have to...
Wing it.
Yep. I can't say that specifically. I don't know how to say it, but you can't take the tourniquet off.
No. Okay.
That
okay.
is
other tourniquet you recommended besides the CAT tourniquet?
It's called a SWAT.
SWAT.
Mm-hmm. SWAT.
SWAT.
It's a big TheraBand looking thing. There's a third way that we can add compression into a wound. So we have direct pressure, we have a tourniquet. The third way is packing the wound. So typically with deep wounds, the problem is that we have bleeders down in the wound, and we can't get to them with putting direct pressure on the surface. That just doesn't help. So we can take different kinds of gauze, whether it's hemostatic, in other words, clot-producing gauze, or just regular gauze, a roll of gauze that you might use. Either one of those is still better than not. And you can use this in conjunction with other techniques, direct pressure and the tourniquet, okay? If it works by itself, great. If it doesn't, you've got other options. But this is an option to get down into the wound and use this gauze to stop the bleeding, to put compression at the blood site, at the bleeding site, down in the wound, and stop the pressure, or stop the bleeding from that pressure. So quick clot is chitin.
Or made with a shrimp shell.
No, quick clot is actually made from clay.
Clay?
It's basically the same kind of slip that they make china out of.
Oh.
But it also has other properties in it for a chemical bonding kind of thing to make the bleeding stop. Celox and Cytoflex are different kinds. They use the shrimp shell. Mm-hmm. So it's a polymer that's derived from the shell of shrimp.
Mm-hmm.
And it,
chitin.
Pardon?
The C-H-I-T-O.
Yeah. Chitosan is actually the polymer that's being produced. So those things, you get them and you take this gauze, which becomes a matrix for a clot.
Good.
And you push it down in the wound. I mean, literally push it down in the wound.
Mm-hmm.
And you pack it tight. And then you put a dressing on top of that and then put some pressure on there. And it may stop the bleed, depending on how severe. It could be a life-threat bleed, but it may not be like an arterial where it's just spurting high in pressure things. It comes in different forms, so a roll of gauze, or in what's called a Z-fold. And you can just hold those in your hand and just feed it into the wound.
So that's a good thing to put in the kids' camping gear when they're...
Yeah.
So either one of those rolls, that would be a good thing.
Yeah, either quick clot or Celox or Cytoflex. The Cytoflex are basically small pads. They're starting to make the rolls. But anyway, the Celox is more like the Z fold and the rolled gauze.
Mm-hmm.
And you can put some of that in a pack to go camping.
Yeah.
I was trying to say camping and pack at the same time. Doesn't work. So the idea is you take this, rip open the clothes, and remove some of the blood if you can, if you have something to kind of sop it up with, so that it's whatever's coming into the wound is, you get down in there and you're using the fresh blood to activate the hemostatic chemicals.
For larger wounds or?
Deeper, I think, is more appropriate. Larger, because it could be a large wound that you could pack. But remember that this is a way to deal with something other than a big spurter. Because
okay.
A big spurter is you're going to have to do a tourniquet. That's your only thing. You can put direct pressure on that, but it's going to be all of your weight all of the time. You let up on that a little bit, and it will start spurting again. So that's why I say if you have a tourniquet, use it immediately.
Isn't this for people on blood thinners?
Not necessarily.
It will overcome the blood thinner, is my understanding.
Sometimes. It depends on what they're doing and what's going on. The reason why I'm hedging on that is because there's some counterindications for using with people with blood thinners. But I can't ask that question at the moment, And at that moment, am I going to use them? Yeah. I'll take my chances. I'm going to try and save their life.
I've been told that the powders are more complicated because they can be carried.
Right.
And the ones that are embedded in the materials are much safer.
Yes, I agree. So I'd use these gauzes first. They're very much more effective. And the gauze has a built-in matrix for clots to build up on. When they get to the hospital, they can remove it and take care of the bleeders. It's quite easy for them to deal with that. The powders and the stuff that you pour into the wound has to be cleaned out.
And don't some of these produce heat that damages the tissues?
Not anymore. Not anymore. So there were two things that were problematic and also questioned when these first came out. Quick clot, the chemical process was exothermic. It produced heat, in which it could have produced enough heat to damage tissue. And then we've got damaged tissue on top of, you know, bleeding, and it just gets really bad. So that they changed the formula, and it no longer is exothermic. It doesn't produce that kind of heat. The other thing that was worried about was with the C-locks, was that the hemostatic chemical would get into the bloodstream and cause anaphylaxis. And anaphylaxis is a severe allergic reaction that basically people can stop breathing and lose their blood pressure, and you can die from it very easily. That's where you'd use an EpiPen. But I've been told by a number of ER surgeons that this stuff doesn't get into the bloodstream, so it doesn't become systemic and it doesn't cause anaphylaxis. It just stays right in the wound. So even if you were allergic to shellfish, this stuff would be okay for you. Anything else? Okay.
So you just jam as much of this in there as you can get in there?
Yep.
And the idea of preserving the clot that's already formed, what function does that clot have?
So if you have a clot already formed at any level, it is stopping some bleeding. It's using
the body.
Well, we're enhancing the body with this stuff. So a clot that's already there means that the pressure is low enough to make a clot happen. The body has already sealed off those veins, capillaries, arteries, whatever it is, most likely capillaries. But if you wanna dab up the blood in the wound, but you don't want to dig it out, is kind of the idea here. Besides getting somebody to swing at you, it's not a good idea.
Question.
Yeah.
A lot of these military applications that have now come into the mainstream.
Yes.
Is that where all this stuff is?
Yes.
In the last, 10 years?
20, 25 years. Almost all of our trauma medicine comes from military. As sad as it is, that's where we learned a lot about this. Yes, the Iran-Iraq war have given us lots of information about this new generation of tourniquet, wherever it went to, is designed out of the flaws that happened on the first six generations. You can use hemostatic dressing, galling rose, or even a clean cloth. Understand this is an order of effectiveness. One of the things that needs to be understood is this idea that you want to get the packing down into the wound. Because if you're just holding pressure up here, this fills in with blood. They're still bleeding. You don't know it, but they're still bleeding. And there's a possibility that the blood will flow into the tissue. If this is muscle, the muscle can be surrounded, the muscle tissues can be surrounded by blood. You can lose a lot of blood in your thigh. It will just pool inside the muscle. So you need to get down into the bleeder, make sure that you're causing compression at the bleeding site, not just on the surface. You want to pack quickly, hold pressure, and if you need to, put some more in. One guy I was talking to, they actually got two rolls of gauze in his arm. It was a gunshot wound. So, direct pressure, tourniquets, packing the wound. Any other questions about that?
This is really advanced first
aid. This is actually really simple, but it has an advanced edge to it, but this is no more advanced than CPR. So with CPR, you guys had, person's had a heart attack, you get on there, you start pushing on the chest doing compressions, whether it is compression-only CPR or full CPR, you're getting blood moving and you're giving that patient a chance to live. Once EMS gets there, they can do their job, right? With stopping the bleed, all we're doing is we're just staunching the bleed long enough for the EMS to get there and actually do their job to save the person's life. With children, it is all the same technique. If you're using a tourniquet, just be aware that the bindings, the particular belt buckles on this thing, can pinch the skin. So you want to make sure as you're putting the tourniquet on that you work it so that it stays flat and doesn't bunch up the skin underneath it. That could damage the skin. The other thing is that the limb may be so small, that tourniquet will not fit. Sorry, just not going to happen. Direct pressure is going to be plenty big, plenty good enough for that. Okay? When do you use these techniques? There is a protocol, and I've talked about it a number of ways, but basically if you have a trauma kit, which has a tourniquet in it, a trauma kit typically has gloves, gauze, usually 4 inches by 4 inch gauze, a number of pieces of that, tourniquets, band-aids, not band-aids, but bandages. And if you don't have one of those, then you have to go to using direct pressure. Pack the wound, direct pressure. If you have a tourniquet, if you have the kit, and the wound is on an extremity, an arm or a leg, then you use your tourniquet. So if it's on the arm or leg, you have a tourniquet, use it. If it's not on the leg, if it's on the neck or one of the joints, one of the junctions, then you have to use packing. You can't use the tourniquet. So pack it. Direct pressure. After EMS arrives, you've been working with somebody else's blood. You do not know what kind of disease they have. There's no time to even ask them. So assume that you have contaminated blood around you. Take your gloves off carefully, wash your hands thoroughly, and remove any blood-soaked clothing, put it in a bag, give it to the EMS guys.
Inside out.
Yeah.
You should say.
Right. So when I said carefully, what I mean is you take one glove, make sure your hands are down. Mm-hmm. Take one glove, grab it by the palm, and gently work it off. When it gets down to about the point where it's starting to come off your fingers, then start gathering up in your hand until it's off of this hand. Ball it up. Mm-hmm. Then go fingers underneath the cuff of the glove. Okay? There may be blood on this side. By habit, I go on this, on the back side. By habit, I go just to the back side. I don't even practice on this side. I just go on the back side and I peel the glove off. And I leave my hand clenched with that other glove in there. I leave that hand clenched until when I pull this glove off, I actually pull my fingers open so that that glove stays buried deep inside the other glove. ABCs of bleeding, right? Yay, you're all gonna be able to do this. Yeah, we got ABC on everything, right? But that's okay. If you have the thing that I want you to take away from this is if you have a tourniquet and you have a major bleed, use it. Use it quickly. The only thing more than tragic is one that can be prevented. And bleeding out is one of the preventables.
So should you not apply pressure to abdominal, like lower abdominal wounds, or?
Yeah, you can apply pressure there.
Or impact and all that, because you talk mostly about like juncture wounds, or you know, the junctions are in
now. We are most effective with extremities. We're semi-effective with junctions, and we're ineffective with torsos, because we can't get enough pressure there. There's just no way we can get enough pressure. Do you put pressure? Yeah, but you're holding what blood from keeping coming from out.
This is an unusual question, perhaps. What about in the instance of a miscarriage?
That is actually, I believe, I'd have to look at some medical literature, But if I was presented with that this moment, I would say that is a torso kind of bleeding. I really can't do anything about that. I do know that massaging the womb helps with closing off the blood vessels after birth, but I don't know about, you know, a spontaneous miscarriage or a traumatic miscarriage, you know, caused by a trauma, an accident, a car accident, or something like that. There is internal injury. Something went really, really wrong that this miscarriage happened, and now you've got a situation that you're dealing with the process that is out of my control. So it's not really, it's a great question. I mean, thinking through the problems that you might face is a great way to deal with them when they happen. Because if you don't think about it up front, you're going to be thinking about it while it's happening.
Is the elevation of the patient in any of these bleed losses a factor? Do you have them flat? Do you have the head lower, the head higher?
So depending on what the bleed is, we're finding that raising the feet doesn't really do that much. So elevation is not that big a deal. You know, I can hold my arm up high for a long, long time. I'm going to have muscle fatigue before I have blood problems, you know, before the blood pressure leaves my fingertips. So the heart is capable of overcoming that kind of gravity. It's not going to make a big difference. If it's a head wound, you don't want to have the head lower than the heart, because you'll develop more pressure in the brain, and that's a problem. But other than that, no. Yes, sir?
Wouldn't elevating the feet help for treating shock?
Not anymore. It's not considered effective use. If the patient is comfortable that way, sure. Because we look to help make the patient as comfortable as possible. If that's what they want, okay. But one of the problems that's also not effective because of the blood pressure stuff, it's a problem because we don't know what kind of back injury happened. And raising the feet may cause more damage to the spinal cord.
Okay. Is there anything you can do for neck wounds?
For what?
Neck bleeding wounds on the neck.
Direct pressure.
Just direct pressure the best you can.
Yeah. Being aware that sometimes you might cut off the airway, cut off the supply. I mean, you got to think outside the box, because there is no box. If you want to know more about this or get the ability to become an instructor, you can go to this website, bleedcontrol.org, and learn all you want to know about this. Also, if you have any questions for me, you're welcome to contact me, and I'd be glad to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Does the Good Samaritan protect people from helping?
Great question. So the Good Samaritan law in Oregon is very strong, and it basically states that what you're doing, if you're doing this to help the person, you're acting in good faith, you are trained to do what you're doing, you're now trained to put the tourniquet.
Yeah, does this qualify?
This qualifies. You know, but If you do stuff, and they're going to come to me and say, look, this is what they did, what would you do since you trained them? And I would say, this is what I do, and this is what I do, and this is the thing I'd look at. And they would go, that's exactly what they did. Okay. And the Good Samaritan law is going to apply. Now, if you try to put a tourniquet on somebody and the seatbelt's in the way and you drag them out of the car, extract them, you're not trained to do extractions. Even though you may not have caused a back injury, they would not be wrong to try and sue you for back injuries. So the Good Samaritan law is about doing what you're trained to do.
I see.
And acting as a reasonable person would act. You still have to ask the patient, can I help you? I see you're bleeding out, can I help you? No, leave me alone. You've got to leave them alone. Once they go unconscious, then the rules change. Because if they go unconscious, you can have implied consent. They're no longer able to make that decision because they may have changed their mind. But the Good Samaritan law is a very good point. Thank you for bringing that up. Thank you, guys.